Hi, it's Jeff Gelman of Solid Canine Training. Today I want to talk to you about prong collars. Some people call them pinch collars. They're not choke chains though. There's a big difference, a dramatic. My story, let me share that with you. 10 years ago, I got my first dog, Max, German Shepherd pup. I had so many behavior problems with my dog. It got to the point, by the time he was 6 months old, he was chasing people down, biting them, chasing dogs down, biting them, pulled down the leash, didn't know any of his commands, barked too long, housebreaking issues. I've been where you are. I went to a bunch of trainers. I actually even sent him away to a board and train. He actually never was trained with any of those training systems. Everybody told me it was the dog. They told me to kill my dog. It's my dog that has problems. You know what I found out? It wasn't the dog. You know why? Max is still alive. Now he's 10 years old. It was the training philosophy. And I am going to be able to cut 2 to 5 years off your learning curve, and you are going to be able to learn to use the tools that I use, the techniques that I do use. And it's not even just about that. It's just about the way we communicate with our dog. Max is still alive. I have worked with thousands of families. I travel the country training dogs. One of the things that I did realize 10 years ago when I was struggling with dog training was I was never told that I was allowed to tell my dog no. I was never told that I was allowed to correct my dog. Now I understand on a lot of indoor classroom training, I understand why they do that. I understand the concept. For a lot of sport, I understand why you wouldn't want to do that. But in the real world, it's mandatory. If you have a dog in the real world, with your real family, in real life situations, you're gonna have to tell your dog no. One of the best tools that I have found to work with every dog, every breed, is a prong collar. But the prong collar is probably the most misunderstood training tool out there. But I want you to know something. If you're training your dog in the real world, outside, not in a classroom, but outside, high levels of distractions, it's really important that you use a tool that works for you. I have found with thousands of dogs, all trained successfully, eventually to be off-leash trained, a prong collar is a great start training your dog. Now, there's a couple different prong collars out there. They're also not used properly. So this is a very important video. With this video, I'm just going to show you on how to pick out the proper prong collar, size the prong collar, and how it's supposed to be put on the dog. I'm going to have some future videos on how to use it for all your different obedience commands. So let's start from the beginning. I like to use Herm Springer prong collars. Now, I never use a prong collar bigger than the 3 millimeter. They have some that are 3.25, 3.75, way too big. Even for a 200 pound dog, I'm finding they're way too big. I prefer the 3 millimeter. Now the great thing about the Herm Springer is that the prongs are rounded. These are rounded tips. Now, some of the other brands out there, you can tell they just chopped it right off and they're a little bit sharp. These are very rounded. Now, if you don't understand the dynamic of a prong collar, it actually does not go into the dog at a direct angle. It actually compresses around the dog's neck. It is not a choke chain. It's the farthest thing from a choke chain. I have trained thousands of dogs. I have a handful of colleagues that train like I do. They have trained thousands of dogs. We have never seen a dog choke on a prong collar. We have never seen one of these prongs go into a dog through their skin. So none of us are seeing that. So I want you to know, they look barbaric. I assure you, and yes, I've put them on me. You can snoop around YouTube for a video of my wife actually yanking it on my neck during my radio show. So the prong collar. The prong collar is composed of separate links, which you can actually remove. So when you buy a prong collar off the shelf or through my website, you can adjust it for the dog, and I'm going to show you how to size it for your dog. But these can be removed. It has a center plate. The new Springer collars have center plates on them, which makes it much easier to put on your dog. Now we've got two rings on the collar. This circular ring right here, all that is a stopper. That just keeps the chain from going around and around. That's just a stopper. This one right there This is what we're gonna put the leash onto. This should always be on the outside away from your dog, and then this one right here should be against your dog's neck. Okay. Now let's talk about opening and closing these collars. Utilizing the center plate, I'm gonna put my thumb here and push. Now, we have to pinch to get it closed. It's important. The reason why we have to pinch to get it closed is because you can see the holes don't line up. You don't want the holes to line up because you want a little bit of tension there. So we have to pinch right here with this hand, and we're lining up the holes now, and now I can fit it through. So again, to take it off, pushing down here and pulling up. Putting it on, I have to pinch. The great thing about a prong collar is this. Prong collars are supposed to be fit up pretty snug and high up on the dog's neck. And I'm gonna do a demo on a dog. You're gonna find, if you struggle right now with your dog pulling on a leash, you're gonna find that you're gonna need such little hand manipulation, leash pressure, when you're working with prong collars. I can't stress enough how many thousands of dogs that I've trained with a prong collar. They're great for dogs that are just out of control. They're great for nervous dogs. They're great for aggressive dogs. How do I know this? Because I have successfully trained thousands of dogs, all different breeds. I've trained dogs that have been shy as can be. I've trained dogs aggressive as can be. The thing about me is, and when you go to my Facebook page, and you go to my blog, and you go to my website, and you watch my YouTube videos, you'll see that I work with a lot of different types of dogs. An important part to remember when you're putting on the prong collar is that it always looks nice and smooth like this. Notice how the chain goes nice and smooth through. A common mistake is when the prong collar is apart, this gets twisted around a little bit. It still connects, that looks fine, but let's look at the chain. This side of the chain is fine, this side is all twisted up. What happens is you don't get that nice little smooth pop that we're looking for. Remember, we're not pulling our dogs. Another thing about prong collars are, a lot of times when people have their dog that pulls them down the street, they're afraid to use a prong collar because they assume that these will be digging into the dog's neck. That's the farthest thing from the truth. The dog stops pulling. Remember, my 5-year-old, my 7-year-old, they walk 100-pound dogs down the street. Why? Because they can communicate with the dog now. We're not going to use strength. We're not going to use strength. So how do you fix something like this? You would make sure that you have it set up from the beginning correctly, around. Let's not forget we can take these links out. All these links are interchangeable because you're going to want it to be fit correctly. If you're putting it over your dog's head, if you have a prong collar like this and you take it over your dog's head and you're putting it over your dog's head like that, it probably has to remove 3 or 4 different links. It's way too big. It's not supposed to go over the dog's head like that, ever, ever. It's always supposed to be unhooked, put around the head, reconnected, and nice and snug. And we're gonna demonstrate that on a dog. So if you find yourself taking this and putting it over your dog's head, it's way too big and the prong collar is not gonna work properly at all. I'm putting the collar on, opening it up like this. I go under the dog's neck. I always connect my collars right in between the ears. Right here. It should be up nice and high. Now, since I like to walk dogs on my left-hand side, we want to make sure that the part where the leash goes on is on that side. Okay. Notice how up high this is. Okay. It's not jewelry, it's a training collar. See how nice and high this is? Nice and snug, and if it slips down, and look at this. just one or two little fingers underneath it. That's all it should be. We don't want it to be sliding down when we're using it. Let's try that again. Okay, good. Again, we get it underneath the dog's neck. I attach it up at the ears. I pinch in. And then I'm gonna just move it around just like that. And if it slides down a little bit, don't be afraid to go like this. Okay? Dogs' necks are the strongest part of their body. All right? Look at how nice and high this sits. Okay? Because I want to get, again, very little pressure we're going to have to use with our pinch collars and our prong collars. Very little pressure. Okay? To take it off, I'm pushing down. Okay? Zelda. For putting on, sit. For putting on. The one that you saw me demonstrating on the dog was the 3mm one. I like this model for dogs that are usually over 50 pounds. This is the 2.25. I like this model for usually anywhere in the 15 to 50 pound range. Now they also make a smaller one, a much smaller one, the 1.75. Now, you say to yourself, why would you need this on a Chihuahua? Well, it's a good question. What I like to say is, just because your Chihuahua can walk you down the street, that doesn't mean it's trained. Okay? Drop the leash of your Chihuahua. Where's your Chihuahua? Also, let's not forget about all the dogs that we've got that are very aggressive, that are small breeds. Let's talk about all the dogs that have been shut down that are small breeds. Again, I'm finding with the thousands of dogs that I'm training successfully, that's an important point there, successfully, that prong collars are probably the number one tool that should be used for family dogs in the real world. Again, I can get dogs to just do about anything inside a classroom. We all can. But I think if we're really being honest with ourselves, we all also know that that doesn't come out of the classroom. I'm not seeing it carrying over in the classroom. And again, I'm not talking about sports. I'm not an agility trainer. I don't do confirmation. I don't do search and rescue. Okay? I'm a real world dog trainer. I train real families in the real world. So I use tools that I'm finding my families are loving and being successful with thousands of dogs. And I'm also finding with thousands of dogs that it is a great tool to be used. Okay. Jeff Gellman, Solid Canine Training. Thank you so much for watching.